Elizabeth.
How'd you get in here?
Elizabeth.
This is both to the director and to the cast. I think that one of the remarkable things about this film is that balance between supernatural and realism, kind of the psychology of it, and how did you go about writing that and make it so subtle and reveal it so slowly, and actors, how did you go about portraying that?
Well, I think it's, in terms of writing it, it's just a matter of never going too far. It's all about just holding off that irresistible beat that you really want to write, but you know you shouldn't, mm-hmm. so you don't. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe write it and then you cut it out and something. It doesn't end up on the screen.
How did you manage to hold yourself back? I think that's probably the hardest thing for a creative.
I just think it's about reading it and reading it and reading it. You sense the rhythm of it. And I think this film has a very distinct rhythm that we really found again from the script when we went, even though like lots of stuff changed in the edit, but to me it was finding that same rhythm that the script seemed to have when you read it. So that's what I was really looking for.
Does the cast have anything to say?
Well, what's so wonderful about Michael's work and his storytelling approach and the intricacy is that eloquent balance that you mentioned, the supernatural, which is fun and exciting, and for an actor to play a character who is seeing dead people, and knowing that other people aren't seeing that, and the heightened state of that, that's really fun and exciting. But then there's so many layers, but the layers of playing someone that is also into analysis and the ghosts that are physically present for him are obviously a metaphor for unsolved issues from childhood and all of these layers that he's woven into the storytelling. So, you know, I love the genre, I grew up, you know, paying to to see every Nightmare on Elm Street in theaters. With my boys, go see them. Love to be scared. And so when I was watching this, and then like, there was the moment of waking up and having nightmares. I'm like, oh, that, I love that chick. a mature man's version. Nightmare on Elm Street. But I just loved it, and all of that is in the script. And I was very honored and grateful that Michael approached me for this, and obviously there are lots of talented Australian actors out there, and I reminded him on our first Skype call, and said, I think you want a man from Queensland, not a man from Queens. It's actually Melbourne, not Queensland, but I'm from Queens, what the fuck do I know? I thought it was funny at the time. But anyway, I really appreciated that he invited me to come play, lovely cast.
And I just to say about, I mean, Adrian's performance, I mean, I don't know to your American ears, but it's a flawless Australian accent that Adrian pulls off, which is just remarkable considering the short amount of two weeks in.
Michael was my dialect coach. Anyway, we have wonderful fellow actors here. My strange menacing father. Just superb, isn't it?
One of the most extraordinary things about the text was the father-son relationship and how that slowly kind of revealed itself. It's a really complex and scary place to go for a father and son. And I don't think it's all that far from the truth.
Speak for yourself. Very lovely that you are all here. See it with an audience, it's lovely, and I feel like very exciting. I think you did a wonderful job, Michael.
Are there any more questions? Well, otherwise, I could maybe. Oh, sorry, is there? Oh, yeah, at the back in the middle.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Two-part question, one's for the director and one's for the cast. For the director, sir. How did you think of this? Like, were you just chilling with your boys, or were you in your house? How did this come to you? And, wait, can I get the second part?
Yeah.
And the second part is for the cast. When you guys went home after you read this, and you filmed this, did you guys have nightmares on your own? I don't want to scare you, but her, she's very young, so I was wondering. Did you get nightmares? Were you scared easily?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, no, not at all. No, I loved it. I thrive on this sort of stuff. I know it's a bit weird because I'm all, you know, like this, but I love that. I read the script and straight away there was this thing inside me that just, I know that sounds so weird, but it just came out. I think everyone has a bit of their inner monster. So no nightmares. I thoroughly enjoyed every part of it, and Michael's amazing. The cast is amazing to work with, and to play opposite Adrian Brody, scare him a little bit. It was really cool.
To answer the first part of your question, well, I mean, originally I was just a very morbid child, so I always had these terrible thoughts when I was growing up. But specifically for this, it was when I was directing my previous film, Till Human Voices Wake Us, which treads on some similar ground, but it's a romance. And I always, when I was shooting it, I was thinking, it's a really scary version of this that I should think about. So it kind of started way back there.
Appreciate your answers, guys. Thank you.
Question here at the front.
Well, first of all, I have to say I'm a big fan of a film George is in called Love Serenade from a number of years back. And I wanted to ask, with the Babadook and now this film, we're starting to see kind of a renaissance in Australian horror films, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that and how you got this project back.
Well, we got it back. Screen Australia is very supportive of it. We had Bankside come on board rather quickly, so that side of it was really supportive and encouraging. I think that Australian films, I think that the concept that's kind of occurring to everyone is that we want to have our films seen by people other than Australians, so we have to do more broadly and more films that have an international appeal, and genre just naturally does. So I think it's coming out of that impulse to create more international fare.
And you said the cinematographer and the set designer or costume designer are here?
Yes.
So to involve them a little bit, I think it's very unusual. This film has a very unusual look. It's not what you think of when you think Australia. It's like gothic, it's gloomy. Can you talk a bit about how you made that happen?
Yeah, well, Steph and I, we came up with a lot of stuff together. We was very interested in the photography of Gregory Crutzen, who just has this kind of strange hyper-realism, but they're photographs, but they look like strange, surreal paintings. And so we kind of started there, and then from there started to create our own look and our own world with it.
Yeah, and I guess a lot, like you were saying about Australian films before, so many Australian films are naturalistic and kind of bleak, or we're known for a lot of naturalistic drama. So to do a film like this was really exciting because from a cinema photographic point of view, you get to play with a lot more camera moves, a lot more stylized lighting. So it's really, really fun for a cinematographer on set to be able to create these looks. And I don't know, you just get to be more playful.
Yeah, it was great. It was a lot of work Steph and I did on the look of it leading up to the film pre-production, and had a lot of lookbooks that we kept going back to and just really getting it very specific. And we definitely didn't want the city that he's in, even though we say it's Melbourne. It's actually shot in Sydney with partially parts in Melbourne. But that was kind of intentional. I wanted it to feel like a mashup of cities so that it didn't distinguish itself as anything but the world we were creating.
Costumes? So, the very first thing I saw about this film was the bugle painting that we had. And the colour palette was, from my point of view, was taken from that painting, which was The Birdcatcher. And it was very beautiful and very subtle, but it also had colours of the Australian outback. And it incorporated just the moodiness and everything of the feel for the film that I wanted. And I think Michael and I just discussed that. I think the main thing that I really loved was the way the little girl, Evie, had on the Mac, which actually, I have to say, was your idea, was this beautiful translucent Mac, because it was raining when she died. And then...
translate on Mac to the New Yorkers.
Oh, I beg your pardon. What do you call it?
A raincoat.
A raincoat, sorry. And the light that shone through this plastic raincoat gave her sort of an eerie feel, and that was something that we could play with a lot with. And so it just all came together, and it was a very organic process. It was lovely.
Just one note on that. Justine, Michael and I made a short film in 2001 together, so we've been collaborating. This is sort of a 14-year collaboration, and Mark Farrell's also in the audience, who was the production designer on that. So anyway, it's very full circle. We've been working together for quite a long time.
I think we have time for one more question, maybe. Yes, please.
I wanted to ask Adrian. Adrian, I know you don't have any children. How did you work on dealing with, playing someone who lost their child? What did you draw on as an actor?
Well, acting is about imagination, and it is useful to have life experiences to draw from. Gain empathy and to understand many things, both positive and negative. And obviously loss, we've all encountered loss in some capacity, and then you draw from that and you can imagine and embody the emotional state of what it would feel like to have lost, and not only to have lost, but to feel a sense of responsibility or the inadequacy, the failings of being a good, worthy parent. And, you know, perhaps it's one of the reasons I'm not a father at this point, because I'm very motivated and attached to my work, and it's very important to be present, to be a great father. My father's in the audience, he's a great father, so I have very high standards. But it comes from understanding, it comes from embracing what feels honest to you and what the truth is, and holding on to that temporarily and feeling for those who are afflicted by those intense moments of grief and the inability to come to terms with that. And also being grateful that that is not my reality.
That's unfortunately all we have time for. Thank you everyone for coming out from Australia.